My first question is whether, you know, we hear so much about Airbnb and Uber in the news. My question is whether this is a passing fad in your view, and in a few years there will be another trend that Silicon Valley has produced that's taking the world by storm, or whether you think that this is a permanent economic and innovative shift that we're seeing in the economy. Arun, I'll start with you.
Okay, well, thanks for the invitation. I'm really delighted to be here. So I believe that it's a permanent shift. I think that we are at the early stages of a reorganization of how we put together economic activity. You know, I look back to sort of like, you know, the late 18th century, and the economy was really organized as a market economy there. And then over the next 200 years, we created organizations of increasing complexity, and we became an organizational economy. In some ways, this, like, you know, this was the last 50 years have been sort of the age of managerial capitalism, where that's how we organize economic activity. We put together large companies with full-time employees. I think what Uber and Airbnb and Gigster and Etsy and companies like that are showing us is that there's a third way, where you create a platform that's sort of a hybrid between a firm and a market, and it sort of draws from distributed resources and puts together, sort of on a continuing basis, a set of goods or services that you used to typically require a company for, a full sort of like, you know, traditional organization for. And so I think of this as sort of a transition from 20th century managerial capitalism to 21st century crowd-based capitalism. So they're not really marketplaces, they're not really organizations, they're somewhere in between. They have some of the features of markets and some of the features of organizations. This is why there's all this complication around how we should regulate them and so on. But sort of briefly, yes, it's, you know, I'm not saying that in 50 years all of the world's economic activity is going to be organized through platforms, but they're going to be sort of a serious part of the landscape, just like traditional large corporations are today.
Since we're among friends, do you want to posit a guess right now about what percentage of businesses will be structured with an on-demand element?
Well, you know, I'm pretty confident that over the next decade, a healthy single-digit percentage of the world's economic activity will be platform-based in different ways, and then perhaps, you know, it's always safe to make predictions about 50 years from now because you're not around to sort of, like, you know, bear the consequences of, like, you know, what you forecast. But, you know, I think that it'll be comparable to the organizational economy in the decades to come.
Okay. Roger, let me turn to you. What if this is the new mode and the organizations are being crafted in this way, what responsibilities do organizations have to their freelancers or employees? Maybe you can talk about how you've structured your firm and then speak a little bit more broadly about how you think what employees are owed or freelancers are owed by firms.
I would first briefly add to Arun's point to say that that freelancing, you know, the concept of freelancing, of marketplaces, of sharing has, you know, of course, been around for centuries, you know, been around forever since the beginning of any economic activity. So I think what we're seeing now is, you know, just to briefly add to it, what we're seeing now is just that technology and, you know, these new consumer products and platforms like Airbnb and Uber are just enabling us to essentially access that more efficiently, right? We're seeing entropy lower. We're seeing the barriers to economic activity that has always sort of wanted to happen. All of these latent relationships that wanted to form are being enabled and streamlined with technology. So I think it's absolutely here to stay. To your question on the responsibilities that that platforms have to their workers, I think we're in a unique transitional period of history right now where you have the option to get a job or to freelance. Freelancing is becoming much more palatable. So, you know, if you join a company like Uber, particularly in some of the new cities, early, you know, Reed touched earlier on Uber's playbook. Well, part of Uber's playbook is that when they launch a new city, in order to balance supply and demand properly, they'll pay drivers to just kind of drive around in circles and wait until they have demand. Which is great because, you know, the early users of of the app get drivers that can pick them up very quickly. So Uber does take some responsibility for making sure that drivers have drivers can earn a living, drivers can get enough hours, right? We're seeing, you know, we're seeing now, particularly in San Francisco, where I'm based, we're seeing a lot of competition between Uber and Lyft, which means that Uber and Lyft are both looking at ways they can get drivers. So, so I think if nothing else, competition will drive this need for platforms to provide a better experience. Now, you're also going to see different modes of retirement. So, whereas the government had pensions and private companies or startups have equity plans, I think this is one of the next questions for freelancers to answer, and it's something we think about. Freelance platforms. It's something we think about at Gigster. You know, how are our freelancers going to retire? And something we've contemplated doing, for example, is taking equity in certain customer projects and rolling that up into, you know, a fund that that our freelancers can have a share of based on their level of activity. You know, we don't know exactly what we're going to do yet, but there's a lot of innovation to be done there.
There's also the topic of discussion about universal basic income.
Yeah.
Arun, do you want to just chat briefly about how viable that idea is, that the government would provide the support?
Absolutely. But just adding to what Roger said, really briefly, this idea of how do you protect freelancers is sort of at the fringes. We're hearing about it in the context of Uber drivers. We're hearing about it in the context of, domestic workers who are operating through these platforms like Handy and TaskRabbit. But soon it's going to be at the center of the economy. I mean, soon we're going to have a lot more full-time jobs that are organized as some form of freelance work in healthcare and energy, in as Uber and Lyft and platforms like them start to sort of become viable substitutes for owning a car. A lot of the employment in the auto industry will sort of shift to this model. And, I've been following the emergence of a platform that is supposed to launch in April called Juno. Again, I have no interest in any of these platforms commercially. But what's distinctive about them is that they've committed to half their founder stock being owned by the drivers by a particular target date, I think 2026. Mm-hmm. And so this represents sort of a new possible direction, and this is to Roger's point, of provider stock options in the same way that we have employee stock options today.
Reddit does that as well.
Yeah?
Reddit's gonna give some equity actually to their users.
Okay, well that's sort of like, a step in the right direction. So you sort of take this to an extreme, and that's when you get to universal basic income. I think the fundamental idea is very simple. Let's give everybody a fixed amount of money every month, independent of their employment status. So everybody in the company gets a check, like $800, $1,000 a month. And I think that this is driven by a couple of observations. One is moving away from a employee-centric economy to a freelance-centric economy, and the need to give people a safety net where they aren't dependent on employment and they have the sort of freedom to get the training that they want, greater mobility. But I think it's also motivated, and in part why there is so much interest in Silicon Valley about this topic is because there's the prospect of wide-scale, sort of large-scale displacement of workers because of automation. This sounds like a familiar story, right? I mean, through history, we've had sort of fears of automation, sort of like, taking away jobs. But there are a lot of people who feel like we've hit this inflection point in the capabilities of digital technologies today, where the pace at which technology will sort of automate jobs will exceed the pace at which it creates jobs. And so looking forward 20 or 30 years, it may be necessary to have a broader safety net in the form of something like a universal basic income. Conceptually, the idea is great. I think that pragmatically in the United States, there's a pretty, there's a pretty tough So political path from where we are today. I mean, we're at least in the United States, and even in the United Kingdom, the idea of the safety net and its funding is typically tied to the private sector rather than the government. Mm. In contrast with, say, many Scandinavian countries who have their flexicurity model where the idea is you pay a lot of taxes and the government protects you. And so for these kinds of economies, like the US and the UK, that path to basic income is probably going to be a lot more challenging than from some other countries like Switzerland, where I think they actually had a referendum about it recently.
Right. Let's talk, the fundamental question is whether this is good, whether it is good for companies and for workers. And so for companies, it provides flexibility. I think undoubtedly this shift is good for companies so long as they can get the skills they need. For workers, it's less clear to me as someone who takes Uber fairly often and hears from the drivers about how many hours they have to drive and how many times the terms of their agreements have been changed and the fares lowered to attract more customers. It's unclear to me that this is a viable model for workers. Roger, the people who you've hired through your platform are mainly working for other companies, so this is extra work for them. Is that right?
That's right.
Okay. Do you think it would be enough to get by if they did not have full-time employment elsewhere?
For many, it is. At Gigster, it breaks down a little differently than Uber. We have higher educated knowledge workers. So we have on the platform project managers, developers, designers. We actually used to have salespeople on our platform as freelancers, but now we've kind of brought them in-house due to sort of 1099 W-2 issues. We've seen that
for some of our developers, they're moonlighting from a job at a top tech company like Google or Facebook. They have their own startup and they use Gigster on the side to sort of pay the bills after they run out of funding or as an alternative to raising money. We've seen that career freelancers move to Gigster because it's an easier way for them to get business. They just write code and get paid. They don't have to worry about any of the marketing side of things. It's very elective for folks. We try to grow the network slowly. Actually, I mean, we could go and onboard 10,000 freelancers, ahead of business, right? But at that point, the freelancer satisfaction would be lower. So something we think about a lot is how do we optimize for having the right band of utilization at any given time. So for us, that's around 60 or 70%. So we're doing, let's say we're doing 500 projects right now. And we need to have, one person per project. Well, we would have, around 700 people. We wouldn't have 2,000 people because then they're not satiated with work. So we try to balance that so that for the ones that kind of want full-time work, it's always available. I would say around a third of our platform is actually full-time engaged. The other two-thirds would be part-time. And of that third that's full-time engaged, there's some people that work, well beyond full-time hours even to make more, and there's some people making up to $500,000 a year because they're able to pick up so much work, and we actually pay people a little differently maybe than other platforms. So we don't pay hourly, we actually pay on a fixed price basis, which attracts a kind of different type of talent, because people that think they can work more quickly will want to do fixed price work because they end up making more per hour.
But it strikes me that this is a skilled job, and earning $500,000 a year is probably that outlier rather than the norm. And in the taxi business, we're not seeing similarly generous wages. You've done some research on this, haven't you? And you've come away optimistic about the impact on wages. And tell us why.
Well, I see two narratives sort of playing out about the impact of sort of a shift to freelance and on demand on the people who are providing the freelance labor. One is sort of the empowered entrepreneur narrative, and the other seems to be sort of the disenfranchised drone narrative. The empowered entrepreneur narrative seems to be that this will empower people to set their own hours, to sort of do the kind of work that they want, to seamlessly move between professions. It sort of decentralizes the ownership of the means of production in society, and that in the long run sort of reduces inequality. And there's a lot of evidence of this in two different ways. I mean, a lot of people who provide through these platforms seem to do it voluntarily and as their first choice. I've seen surveys from the US government that show that 8 out of 9 freelance workers, people who are self-employed or sort of small business owners, would not choose a different model of work even if given the choice. I've heard this through sort of narratives from, so for example, I see Stefan in the audience, the CEO of Upwork.
We'll be on stage later.
There's sort of like, you know, massive scale sort of freelance work through a platform like Upwork where people are choosing it because they want the flexibility. Now, the flip side of this is a fear that sort of like, you know, platforms will get larger and larger, and as a consequence have more and more sort of power to be able to sort of capture the value that the providers are creating. And I think central to, I'll make two quick points. One is that central to this sort of debate about like, you know, are freelancers happy? You know, isn't so much like, you know, when freelancers, we hear them talking about how they want to become employees. If you sort of dig a little deeper into what they really want, they don't want full-time employment. What they're looking for is the nice things that go with full-time employment, like income stability, like benefits, that because of the fact that we have been through 100 years of the organizational economy, are sort of disproportionately available only to people who are full-time employees and not to people who are freelancers. And so I think making freelancers happier has more to do with reconstructing the social safety net and sort of establishing parity that way, and less to do about the form of work. The second point I wanted to make real quickly is that I have been doing research for about a year, monitoring wage rates on freelance platforms and comparing them to the Bureau of Labor Statistics averages for, so for example, sort of a plumber in New York on a freelance platform versus the Bureau of Labor Statistics average wage for plumbers in New York. Mm-hmm. And I find that, you know, there are many professions for which wage rates online are sort of consistently higher than the national averages after accounting for the commission that the platform takes. And there are other professions for which they're a little lower. And what seems to distinguish these two kinds of professions is whether you need to be physically co-located with the customer who you're providing service to. So if you're, you know, if you actually have to physically be where the customer is, then there isn't sort of a huge rush of supply into the market when the platform comes along. And because of the transparency of the marketplace, sort of wage rates go up. Like, you know, you can sort of hire a highly rated person. More qualified people come to a platform because, like, you know, or the better people come to the platform because there's sort of the opportunity to distinguish yourself and get a higher wage rate if you're better. The motivation of people goes up. There is also sort of like, you know, the possibility of injecting a lot of demand, injecting a lot of supply into a platform, and that happens more for things like graphic design, where it doesn't really matter where you are. And so that seems to be the distinguishing factor now. But right now, from what I see, sort of the prognosis thus far is not, it's not all negative. I mean, like, you know, and there's certainly a lot of positive to it. And so I think both narratives are right. You know, it's just a question of which, to what degree each is going to play out, and that's going to be contingent on the policy choices that we make.
Okay, Roger.
Yeah, I'd briefly follow up to that. I think where work can be viewed as more of a commodity, efficiency is actually, I think it's actually an enemy to the freelancer. It's great as a consumer because with services like Uber and Lyft, you know, they're kind of squeezing the amount that drivers make to a very low level. Because you can just tap a button and they'll find somebody who's nearby who's willing to take a ride for an even lower and lower amount of money. With a platform like 99designs, you know, some of you may remember when that launched, there was a huge backlash from designers because suddenly as an end customer, you could go in and design became a commodity where you could say, I want a logo design, I'm willing to pay $400 for that. And then so many designers would compete that they would submit 100 logo designs for free, and then you could pick whichever one you wanted. So 99 of those people weren't even getting paid a dime for the work that they did. So I think social programs like basic income will be essential, particularly to support people who are doing work that in the past has been viewed as more of a commodity, because new technology platforms will take any work that's remotely commoditizable and drive the efficiencies down as low as they can possibly go. I think work that's more differentiated, to one of your earlier points, is a place where freelancers can stand out. They can build their own, they can build their own reputation digitally. Professional reputation, the concept of the resume is coming online now for more and more professions. As an engineer or a designer, you know, today you have your portfolio online, so someone can hire you entirely based on that.
Yeah.
And you can kind of build this you know, strong professional identity and kind of build your own brand. But if you're doing commodity work, that's going to be much tougher for you.
There is a more fundamental question, which is, I think that everyone, especially in Silicon Valley, takes it as a given that every other industry should learn from the innovation that's happening there. So we see Uber, Airbnb. We're seeing Silicon Valley companies spend billions of dollars in an unsustainable way to drive prices down. So there's a question of sustainability for these businesses. But then there's also the question of, unless someone's trying to start in this room, the business, the Uber of X. What application do these findings have to other businesses, whether it's, you know, manufacturing and beyond? So maybe, yeah, take either one of those.
All right. Well, I mean, you know, it seems important to distinguish between Uber and Airbnb here, because one is relatively commodity-like, and they're sort of engaged in this bruising battle for market share. And they are spending billions of dollars trying to sort of capture market share. And we heard a lot about sort of the, you know, the blitz tactics
right.
from Reed in the last session. Airbnb, on the other hand, like, you know, the providers set their own prices. And in some ways, they don't have the same sort of level of spend to capture market share. It sort of seems much more at equal.
But they're losing over $100 million a year.
True, but they're,
which
they're,
isn't chump change. Yeah, in the Valley, that's chump change,
yeah,
but not in Chicago.
But they're still a pretty young company, right? I mean, this is sort of like, you know, that sort of early growth phase. But, you know, to the second sort of part of your question, which is like, you know, where should we anticipate this? What other parts of the economy should we anticipate this in? And like, you know, what can they learn? You know, we've already started to see a shift in, like, you know, different sectors of manufacturing because of 3D printing, of additive manufacturing, which can, and, you know, I sometimes, you know, there's a company based out of Brooklyn called Shapeways that allows you to buy a design that someone has created, and then Shapeways will 3D print it and send it to you. To me, this reflects sort of just how profound the transformation towards sort of platform-based businesses that 3D printing can be. Yeah. In the following sense, which is that much like you know, the emergence of digital music sort of democratized the creation of music. Anybody could create a tune and sort of post it. And then you have intermediaries like iTunes and Spotify that still sort of have market power. But the ability to create was sort of democratized significantly because the rendering in some ways, like, you know, became a lot less sort of capital intensive.
Right.
Right. I mean, you didn't
and
have to get
it. Distribution was
true. Yeah, and distribution. And so you might start to see similar sort of things happening for the creation of simple physical objects. Because 3D printing is getting increasingly sophisticated.
Which will have an on-demand business model?
They could have an on-demand business model in the following sense, that, like, you know, I want to create, say, a sort of a fairly complex artifact. I want to create jewelry, or I want to create a particular machine part, or I want to create, like, you know, a cell phone case, or I want to create, like, you know, sort of a bicycle chain. You know, my ability to do this is enhanced dramatically as an individual. Because I don't need to sort of get the manufacturing and distribution capabilities before I can go to market. I can simply do the design and then I can list it on a marketplace, and that rendering will be taken care of by the platform. I'm also really sort of excited about the prospects of these platform-like models for healthcare and for energy. These are two sectors in which I think we're going to see pretty massive change over the next decade. Once the battery technology for storing solar power starts to become sort of more reliable, and you know, you can, and there are a number of different competing firms here. There's, like, you know, the Elon Musk's sort of plant in Detroit. There's a lot of research that's coming out of the US government that makes me believe that in 5 years to 10 years, we will have sort of batteries that you can buy at home and use to sort of store your solar power. And at this point, the distribution and production model of energy will change dramatically, because you can start to create sort of local markets rather than it being completely centralized. And for low-end healthcare, I think you've got the similar. So, I mean, I don't think that I'm ever going to go to a peer-to-peer market for open heart surgery, but
let's hope not.
Yeah, well, but for things like, you know, sort of in-home care for, like, you know, I cut my finger cooking and, like, you know, need it stitched up, I think the peer-to-peer model lends itself very well. And so we might sort of start unbundling the hospital.
How long will that be before we see that?
With healthcare, it's really hard to make predictions because they've been particularly resilient to sort of changes induced by digital technologies over the last 20 years. But I think that what's fundamentally different about this wave of change is that it's going deep into sort of physical world industries, right? I mean, you've got the software platforms, of course, and you've got sort of like, you know, the more information-based platforms, but we've also seen sort of short-term accommodation, point-to-point transportation. And so the idea of sort of combining the on-the-ground logistics of a physical world business with a platform-based business model, we're starting to create a playbook for this. And so once that comes together, I can certainly see it translating to other sort of, you know, deeply physical world industries like energy and healthcare.
Okay. Roger, beyond energy and healthcare, anything else you'd like to add about the implications of this for other businesses?
Yeah, I think many of you in the room are, you know, are executives at large companies, and you know, the advantage of being a big company is you know that you're providing a product or service that people want, and you already have that part figured out. Well, with many startups in Silicon Valley, they're still struggling to figure out, you know, are they delivering a product or service that people actually want? So I think what you can more learn from these, you know, kind of innovative operational techniques in Silicon Valley is, you know, is just that. It's on the operational side of your business because you know your customers, you know the product and service side. So you can sort of, you know, you can look at both how you deliver your products or services and how you fulfill your products and services. And if you know, in each of those realms, there are operational techniques you can draw from unbundling some of these successes. So you look at something like Uber and, you know, I would say, frankly, Gigster was very inspired by how they deliver their service. If you want to get a car, you simply push a button and a car shows up in 2 minutes. That's great. That's very, very easy. You don't have to call somebody. You know, you don't have to do what you used to have to do to get a taxi or go out to the street and raise your arm. it's become a lot easier to get a taxi. So we asked ourselves, you know, we're in the business of making custom software that solves business problems. So we thought, what if you could push a button and get software? What if we could put a software team in everyone's pocket the same way Uber put a car in everyone's pocket? So, you know, you could look at on-demand companies and say, well, I already know I'm providing a valuable service. How can I deliver that in a more streamlined way? How can I deliver that in a more on-demand way? From the marketplace angle or the sharing economy angle, you could look at how you fulfill your service. So Uber didn't hire a million drivers. They built a network of a million drivers. And you know, that brings with it certain operational efficiencies and certain advantages. In theory, they have 100% utilization. They're not paying those drivers when those drivers aren't actually working, right? So that's an advantage we have. That's an advantage we have at Gigster as well. We have 500 developers, but they're not always working. And when they're not working, we don't pay them. So you know, the economics start to make a lot more sense. So, you know, you could look at different business units, and you could look at, or actually, I would flip it around and look at, you know, your favorite startups that you feel are the most disruptive. Unbundle why you think they're so interesting and see if you can take any of those pieces and operationalize them.
Oh, Roger, I'm going to ask you one more question, and then I'm going to open it up. Who is the startup, in your view, as we think about the on-demand or the platform space, that is most disruptive that no one is talking about?
I would say not Uber, although we've
talked. Because everyone's talking about it?
Spoken so much about Uber. Well, because everyone's talking about it, not only that, but I think Uber is going to get severely disrupted here in the future. Disruption, you know, of course, is a double-edged sword. So my personal theory on them is that self-driving cars will kill any advantage they have because their driver network is their moat. That's their competitive advantage, right? And once every car can go pick somebody up, Uber won't have that anymore. So I think they're in big trouble.
Their hope is that you're going to give up your car before that happens, right? So then you'll need to use them because you won't have purchased a car. That's the hope.
But you need to use them or really any other auto manufacturer at that point. I think the auto manufacturers will start competing with them. And that'll be an interesting full circle turn of events because what auto manufacturers do building cars will now become kind of the hard thing. That will become the moat because it'll be easy to go and get a car. Go ahead.
So I've got three in mind, and again, like, you know, with the caveat that, like, you know, I have no commercial relationship with any of these companies. One is Juno that I mentioned, because they're sort of promising a new model of a relationship between a platform and its providers. Mm. And it remains to be seen whether this will become the template where, like, you know, the providers own the platform or at least part of the platform. Mm. A second one is a company called Hourly Nerd. They're pretty small, but this is an MBA consultant on demand. And, you know, none of my MBA students at Stern aspire to be Hourly Nerds yet. But some of them are actually sort of, like, you know, paying for part of their MBA by freelancing on Hourly Nerd. But this is because it sort of represents a move of the on-demand economy, the first sort of evidence of a move of the on-demand economy, outside of, like, you know, platforms that take freelance offline and make them freelance online, taxi drivers to Ubers, like, you know, sort of, you know, home workers to, you know, task rabbits and handy workers. And so that's sort of a sign. And a third company is, again, a New York City-based company called Work Market. And the reason why I'm interested in them and following them and feel that they'll be disruptive is that they're a software company. But they're a software company that are creating products that will allow a traditional organization to integrate freelance work into a corporate workflow. And so, you know, we're going to move beyond project-based work to actually saying, well, I've got this workflow, here's an employee, but these pieces, I'm going to tap into an on-demand platform to sort of get the labor for this. And so it sort of expands the possibilities for labor disruption through on-demand platforms significantly.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to open up to questions. I'll start with the app. We have one that says, is there more risk with implementing platforms and freelancing due to less control by an entity? Are there risks such as quality control?
Okay, I can take that if you want. You know, I think in the early stages, possibly. And it depends on the relationship that the platform has with its providers. I think, you know, AirBnB is an example of a platform that has a good relationship with its providers. Most of the providers like AirBnB. The founders go around sort of staying with sort of, you know, super hosts. They build community sort of on the ground, city by city. And what ends up happening is that there's not just happy providers with the platform, but you start to create sort of the networks of knowledge and the sort of the communities that employees typically get from a traditional corporation. And so in a natural way, things like quality control and risks of inconsistency in provision start to become lower because you're creating in some sort of odd way like, you know, a crowd-based alternative to an organizational culture or to organizational knowledge. And so if a platform chooses that kind of relationship with its providers, then it is much less likely to face the kind of inconsistency or quality control or risks associated with the platform-based model relative to someone who has tighter control over full-time employees.
I would add to that. This is certainly something we see at Gigster. We're building software, which is typically something that has a lot of quality controls associated with it, and usually you're working with full-time employees when you do it. I think it's not insurmountable, but you do have to approach quality control very differently with a freelance platform. So there's no free lunch, of course. You can't just say, oh, I'm going to make everyone a freelancer and it'll work just as well. So you gain some efficiencies when you do that, but you also gain new challenges. And we've had to reimagine how quality control works. So it's now this peer-to-peer, we have like a peer-to-peer code review system, and we have the concept of, you know, sort of karma points internally in the network. So when you deliver software, if you deliver it on time at a high customer satisfaction, and everyone on your team gives you good kind of 360 reviews, then you end up getting more points, and you can cash those points in to get more projects. So the freelancers with the most points end up actually getting the most work. So we've found that for us, the concept of employment actually exists more so on a spectrum. You know, unlike maybe the traditional company where you would hire somebody and okay, now they're in and they can do whatever they want. With Gigster, once we accept somebody, you know, they go through a couple interviews, of course, but they join and they start with a low amount of karma. They have to do, you know, simple projects, right? And once they've done a good job on five little projects, and they get five medium-sized projects, and then they can do, you know, they can do bigger projects after that. So that way, we don't expose the the higher paying customers, the VIP customers, to these kind of early freelancers that haven't proven themselves. But I mean, we've just scratched the surface. We're a very young company. We're about a year and a half old. So there's a lot more we have to learn. I think we've gotten to a good place, but there's a lot. I think there in the next 5 to 10 years, there's going to be a lot of invention in this area.
All right, I'll take a question from the audience. Do you mind introducing yourself and saying where you work?
Sure. Stuart Lombard from Ecobee. So my question is this. Should we really be hand-wringing about software eating the world and labor dislocation? So I think, there was probably an Economist Innovation Forum 200 years ago having this same discussion. And, if you look at employment statistics in the U.S., employment has almost doubled since the mid-1970s, if I'm not mistaken. And, unemployment rate is right now around 5%, I think, and about 2.9% for college grads. So, should we really be worried, or, aren't these the salad days? Isn't this as good as it gets? And, isn't household income, continuing to grow and all those kinds of things? Isn't it just getting better?
Sure. So I don't think we should be worried, but I think that we should watch carefully, and we should try and unpack what exactly the numbers that you're quoting are measuring. I think a lot of what is being counted as employment now is in fact freelance work. And so the unemployment numbers may continue to go down, but they don't reflect the fact that a larger and larger fraction of what is being sort of measured as employment is in fact work that, because what does the survey ask you? They ask have you sort of done work for money, in the last month? And how many hours have you done work for money? They're not sort of unpacking the difference between working full-time for a company and working freelance either on a platform or off. I'm sure that there were discussions perhaps not in comparable settings. 200 years ago or when the automobile came along, I'm sure that there were lots of discussions around sort of the shifting nature of work when mass production came along. But I think what we need to focus the discussion on isn't so much about, whether we are sort of moving, how much work there is, but given its shifting composition and giving the shifting sort of model of providing work, how do we construct new funding models for the social safety net? Because if we ignore the fact that we're going through the shift today, we're going to look back in 10 years and say what happened. We used to be a society where there was some reasonable level of protection, some reasonable level of sort of stability. People took paid vacations, they had limited work days, they had insurance of different kinds. And this has sort of slipped away without us noticing. And so, I sort of make this point, there are three or four sort of key policy challenges that will sort of determine whether or not this is something that we should have worried about or not. And, I've been trained to say this, but I go into them in some depth in my forthcoming book, which is called The Sharing Economy. Eventually sort of whether or not we look back on this time as being one where we were worrying too much or worrying too little will have to do with how we address these three or four key policy challenges.
All right, thank you for the tough question. Please keep them coming. Does anyone else? Yes, go ahead.
Shane Zabrodoff, Pilot Project International. I have a question. I mean, obviously, we've been talking about crowdsourcing and certain things, and we kind of touch and dance around this. My question, and I also heard, I guess, some of your earlier comments, what about in terms of intellectual property and so forth and that ownership? Obviously, organizations, they look at their product they're developing and so forth, and they try to integrate these external parties. How do you deal with some of those hard issues?
I can take this. I think it's natural for there to be concerns when freelancers are passing your intellectual property around, so to speak, and you have to trust a new type of organization with your data. I think fundamentally, as freelancers start to see more work coming from work platforms, they'll develop more allegiance, loyalty, more allegiance and loyalty to these work platforms, which I think will enable a new level of trust for consumers. So you have different, you know, there are different types of freelancer networks, but the ideal thing you'd want to look for if you're looking to have work outsourced or crowdsourced or whatever it is a network that shows your IP to fewer people within the network, because that just lowers risk. So as opposed to a model that's more like a marketplace where you maybe post a job and, you know, hundreds or thousands of people could see it, perhaps you'd want something where fewer people would be exposed to that work. But ultimately, you have to ask yourself if you can trust that when you've kind of signed an NDA, for example, with that company, and that they have freelancers that are under NDA, you know, will those people actually live up to that? I think it boils down to the maturity of the platform and how much the platform is doing for freelancers.
I think it comes up a lot with hackathons too, which companies are increasingly using as recruiting tools, and a lot of people won't want to take part unless they're able to claim the IP. Yeah. So there's this, it's a really hot issue, I think, that you ask about. Yes, in the center right there.
Gentleman right here.
Oh, sorry, we'll go here and then we'll go over there. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, thank you. My head's in the screen here. My name's Peter Gertler. I'm with HDR, and I'm from a very traditional civil engineering company doing infrastructure projects, but I'm the innovation guy. I'm particularly interested in the interfaces or the sweet spots between traditional legacy type companies like mine and the future shared economy type services. Has there been much thought or research around where those sweet spots are and where the sort of value add between where a company, very traditional legacy type company, and the new companies that are emerging can really build together?
I can give you a couple. One is certainly in the efficiency with which you use your workforce. I think that there are new efficiencies that are created by platforms like Gigster and Upwork and others. And it's certainly worthwhile for any company to pay attention to that labor efficiency front. I think that the sharing economy is inventing to sort of like, you know, and this may be particularly pertinent to your industry, but the sharing economy is creating new models of building infrastructure, and I think of them as the invisible infrastructure approach, where rather than making large centralized sort of capital intensive investments in, say, transit systems, you build a trusted platform that taps into distributed resources, like empty seats in people's cars. And there's a company based out of France called BlaBlaCar, which is city-to-city ride-sharing. They have 25 million users. They carry more people every day than Amtrak does today. They carry four times as many people in France as the Eurostar train network. They have not built anything new. They've built a digital platform, and they're tapping into decentralized resources. So for a company interested in infrastructure deployment to sort of say, well, you know, what pieces of this project need centralized capital investment, and what pieces can be sort of created by building the right platform and tapping into decentralized resources and sort of a new public-private partnership model, that's another great opportunity there.
I'm going to take, if you don't mind, I'm going to take the last question because we have to wrap up. Where was it? Yes.
Hello, my name is Ali Tafti from the University of Illinois at Chicago. A question first, what does a sharing economy platform look like when it's designed from the great ground up, perhaps to be for the employees, to be designed to empower employees? And maybe can you comment on some efforts that you see about that? And secondly, what do you see about the polarization of employee wages and perhaps in your research, Arun?
Okay.
I can take the first one. So I think the first question to ask is, what problem would this sharing economy be solving, or what efficiency would this be creating? So I've seen a number of people look at trying to build knowledge sharing, you know, sort of knowledge sharing economies within companies. So whether it's community or whether it's question and answer or something like an idea market where, you know, an employee can submit an idea and other employees can vote on that idea. You know, anything from, you know, I don't like the lunches to, you know, I think we should be doing this feature product or trying this type of marketing technique. I think getting people together and creating community within a company definitely enables efficiencies, and you know, perhaps to your point, can make you know a more traditional workforce look more like a sharing economy. I think there's great technologies today that enable that. Slack is one that I would highly recommend if you haven't tried it. Yeah. I would just have you know one of your teams try out Slack. Here I am advertising for it. But we use it internally, and we've found that for certain types of communication that don't have to go over email, it's actually eroded away a lot of the email, and it's eroded away a lot of the meetings, because for what would have been a meeting, it's you know went from being something we'd have to sit in a conference room to now you don't even have to go to someone's desk and talk to them. You just send them an instant chat message. But as well, we actually use Slack to power our distributed workforce. So I think technologies like that enable more real-time collaboration, more question and answer, more sharing can absolutely yield efficiencies.
And just to add to that real quickly, you know, certainly sort of shared ownership is sort of a big part of thinking about building a platform that is sort of like, you know, provider-centric. Like, you know, not just sharing in the flows, but sharing in the stock, in some sense, sharing in the capital, not just in like, you know, the wages. I think like, you know, and this may sort of go to answering a different question as well, but I think creating the right platform culture is critical. Much like you have organizational culture, you have like, you know, what I think of as platform culture, which has to do with sort of, you know, building the community structures in some ways that we've gotten used to looking for in the organizations that we've worked for, right? I mean, over the last 200 years, as other sort of forms of community have fragmented because of technological progress, the organization has become an important community block, a community element for many of us. Like, we feel a sense of kinship, a sense of membership. We sort of like, you know, have our friends there, and this is an important part of society. I think an employee-centric or like, you know, a provider-centric platform will think about sort of building those kinds of structures so that there's a sense of belonging and a sense of connectedness among the people, even if they don't work full-time for someone.
I like that idea of platform culture, yeah. And we'll end on that. So Arun and Roger, thank you so much. Please join me in thanking the panelists, and I'd like to welcome Vijay back to the stage.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.